Hey Tom, how's it going in the class? Enjoying it? In the old days, we relied on technology like phone systems and so forth to talk to our students for more than 100 years. In the 1980s, we got excited about things like floppy disks as a way to share resources with our students, right? And then later on, of course, we got into the zip disks. Got us even more excited how much stuff we could store on that. But today, no, we've got cameras. We've got cameras that we can put on our laptop computers. And we can do webinars and webcasts with them. And you just put that right on top there, put our little headsets on, and off we go. And we have a little class going, a little session with our students. It's really amazing what's possible today in terms of communication with our students, how technologies have evolved, almost seamlessly we can interact with our students today. This session is, in fact, on using, your laptop, your desktop, or other technologies to create a webinar or a webcast with your students. The rationale is students want to have some kind of synchronous experience with you. They want to sense that you care as an instructor, that you're there for them, you're present, and you'll give some feedback to them. That's the rationale here. And it makes a lot of sense, right? If you're taking a class as a first-time online learner, you want to know that the instructor's there and it's going to look out for you, no matter what the technologies they're using. You've got many out there to choose from for web conferencing: Centra, Adobe Connect Pro, DimDim, Illuminate, you name it. You've got all sorts of course casting equipment out there: MediaSite Live from Sonic Foundry in Madison, Wisconsin, Livestream, Tegrity, all sorts of technologies. I mean, even the Dalai Lama's doing live stream. The Dalai Lama's twittering as well. You've got Tegrity. Many universities across the United States and other countries are using Tegrity to stream up engineering classes like the University of Central Florida does. MediaSite Live, here's a web shot of their website. Echo 360 for lecture capture. So many of these tools out there today to choose from. This is not a technology problem, it's a use issue today. We have even open source video platforms from Kaltura. If you do web conferencing, you might get involved in using tools like polling, surveying, live video, screen sharing, voice over the internet, whiteboards, chats. There's all sorts of tools embedded in these web technologies, in these web conferencing like Illuminate, Adobe Connect Pro, which is what we use at Indiana University currently. You can check on student progress with them. See if they've, check, see if they're learning, what you. And see what they're not learning. Check on current topics or add current topics into your class through a quick synchronous session. A little variety and novelty never hurt anyone. It allows you to go across the globe to your students and be there for them. But have a ritual, have an assistant, have someone there to help you out within that class. That will get that sense of caring again. So there's a checking on students. This is a pro here. Interactivity is a pro. Immediacy, connectivity, multiple perspectives, these are all pros. Cons are that you might not have eye contact with your students. There might be a time zone delay, or they might be at different time zones around the world. But I find that when I combine a synchronous event, a live session with my students, and an async, it goes wonderfully well. If I bring in an author after we discuss them, for instance, maybe we read a book chapter, we bring in the chapter author, whether they're coming from another country or the beach or wherever in the world. Bring in those conference keynotes, invited speakers free to your classes. Have a webinar on different topics each week where you bring someone in. This will get students really excited about your content because it's not just the book, it's not just you. There are other experts you're bringing in from around the world. You might bring in, as shown here, the authors of books or the conference keynotes from the Philippines or from Australia or wherever the conference is being held that your students couldn't necessarily get to. Or maybe there's a streamed up talk from the Library of Congress your students might access. So it might be an archived event that you might bring into your class that's already been saved. There's all sorts of streamed classes from around the world that you can filter through, pick through the best ones to use for your students. So send out your courses, send out your contents, but then think about reusing, as what's being done here at Monterey Institute of Technology in this screenshot here. They're reaching out tens of thousands of new students through web conferencing. MIT does open courseware videos and puts them on the web for anyone to use, watch, share. Many universities have their own portals their own places that you can go to find videos that have been shared. YouTube has university sites in YouTube EDU. Hundreds of universities are taking advantage of that today, where lectures have been posted up online. In fact, most universities today are having strategic planning for webcasting and web conferencing. This has exploded so much that universities are now planning for it, strategically thinking about where they should go next with course casting equipment, with training of instructors on how to use it. Whether they're doing introductions of their class, whether they're doing live research and showing it up on the web for others to see, or pubcasting where they put a video behind research that they've published. There's so many ways to use video to share, as we pointed out in another program in this series. Broadcasting surgeries in the medical field. The costs have come down. Technologies have become more familiar for people. Some people, like Solomon Kahn, have created over 1,000 free video lectures in math, science, business, and other areas that are all free to the world. When you have all this content, you might need browser tools to find it, like MIT has built. Now, some final advice here. Practice. Get there early. Get all the other stuff off your laptop so you're not clogging up space. But practice and make sure your students know why you're doing the web conference. Have a schedule. Have an agenda. Schedule breaks in that agenda. Avoid talking for more than 15, 20 minutes without a survey question or a polling question embedded in. And if students miss the class, you might archive it for them so they can come back and watch it later. Review the content at the end. Summarize what it is that you went through. You might have a synchronous session and then an asynchronous discussion after it for students to reflect on all the content that you just went through. And before you even get started, you might put up police tape with a do not disturb sign on your door so someone doesn't randomly open the door up while you're presenting. Yellow police tape you might be able to find from trainerswarehouse.com and other places. Set a time for this event. Maybe rotate the time for different start times every week for people around the world. Or vote on times, having students decide on what time fits best for them and for you to think about what time fits best in your schedule with your students for this semester, for this class. Have an agenda. Don't just go haphazardly into the synchronous session, but plan it out with guidelines on how students should approach this synchronous session. While you have all those plans, you still need to be flexible. You still need to be open to things that come about that, you know, things happen. Frustration can easily arise from technology downtimes, things that don't go the way you had initially planned for it to go. You can avoid some of that by attending your instructional consulting offices or teaching and learning centers office sessions. There are brown bag lunches. There are workshops. There are symposia that they might have on different topics. You might watch expert videos that have been done by others to get tips from them. Think about when and where you might webcast. Think about webcasting within your classes. We've gone well beyond the days of floppy disks and, you know, telephone calls and so forth. We've got so many ways to communicate with our students, and webcasting, webinars, and other video kinds of technologies enable us to provide a synchronous presence with our students. But plan it out. Try it out. Get there early, because undoubtedly something's going to happen, whether it's with the audio, whether it's with the video, or maybe the start time issues, or maybe you have a huge file that needs to be uploaded. So you need to make sure that you spend enough time on the front end getting that file uploaded so you can use it. Or maybe test out the websites that are there. There's so many opportunities for synchronous to extend your class out. This is definitely an exciting time for all of us to be able to get global perspectives, international experts, as well as get your own course content out for others around the world. Good luck with the synchronous sessions that you might, in fact, be using soon. This is Curt Bonk coming to you from Indiana University Instructional Consulting Office within the School of Education here at IU. Good luck.